China to tell us more about the peace and security developments in that country, the youngest in Africa, by the way. But first, let's listen in to what the two principals there had to say after signing that peace agreement a while back.
The agreement we have just signed today must mark the end of conflict and war in our country. We should concentrate on timely implementation of the agreement, rededicate ourselves to unite our people and work for peaceful transfer of power through the ballot boxes rather than through the bullet and then through the barrel of the gun. The agreement is rather difficult. It is difficult because see the size of the parliament, see the size of the cabinet and many others. And so in terms of payment, how do you pay them?
I would urge again the heads of state and government of IGAD to focus after this on the implementation of the agreement. Somebody said before that the devil sometimes is embedded in the implementation.
Those are the two main protagonists there making statements a while back after signing that peace agreement. I understand there's another set of peace agreement that is supposed to be signed next week. In studio, once again, I have Ambassador Ajongo with me. Ambassador, good to see you.
Thank you.
Welcome to the program.
Thank you very much.
First question first. Many people are asking, is this deal going to last? Is it going to offer the people of South Sudan solution to the problem that has been affecting them for a while now?
Yes, I mean, we have to be optimistic. I could tell you that this peace deal is likely to hold because there is a popular demand for peace and the need for peace across the South. This gives an assurance that this time around, we are going to get it right.
You know, the reason as to why I did ask you that question is because, you know, this deal encompasses or takes care of the two main protagonists, that is SPLM and SPLM-IO. And I understand that there are other smaller rebel groups that are also coming up in South Sudan. Are they taken care of for this deal?
The process in Khartoum is actually more inclusive. There are a few politicians opt out because they propose the two main issues were the power sharing, which was concluded between the two main rivalries. There were two other rebel groups that wanted to see federal system as a system of governance included in the peace, in the final document. It was not there, but when they signed the when we had the first initials of the governance in the country, they came in and the process are going. They are still being conducted.
Yes.
The contact is going on. The process is going. We only just had a break because of the heat in Khartoum. So by the time we go back, more likely everybody is going to join in.
I'm sure critics will say that we've seen other previous deals that have, you know, fallen where, you know, both parties have violated some of the issues within those deals. Perhaps can you tell us what are some of the contentious issues that has made these deals fall and have they been, you know, taken care of in this latest deal?
Well, the previous deals we had few issues. One of the 2015 there was an issue of the two armies, which was really an issue. The two parties were made to sign a deal where we had two armies stationed in the same capital. And then because of the resources, the region fell behind. There was nothing done to make sure that at least the two armies are harmonized or brought together. And as a result, peace collapsed. So now, it was more or less on a structure, the way the agreement was structured, rather than the peace implementation itself. It was not practically to be implemented because of the resources, the timeline.
Understand that the final peace deal, once again, is going to be signed next week. There the deal was signed in Khartoum, I believe, in Sudan before. And there are some of the South Sudanese people who had an issue with the location being Khartoum. So where will this next week's deal going to be signed? Where, have you decided on the location, perhaps?
There is no any other peace to be signed. What is remaining is actually working on the matrix of implementations. Mm-hmm. The peace process has gone. They have initial domain issues. Mm-hmm. The governance was the issues to do with the representation of the movement, of the rebels mm-hmm. in the government mm-hmm. at the national level and also at the regional level. This thing was done. What is remaining now in Khartoum is the matrix is how the peace is going to be implemented. Mm-hmm. That's what is coming up.
Yeah, perhaps I'm sure many people like to get answers to this question. There are political prisoners, I believe, in Juba. Are they going to be released? Perhaps there's an individual called, goes by the name, by Dr. Peter Biarajak. He's a very, he's a contributor to Bottom Line Africa on many occasions. I understand he was arrested by the NSS, that is South Sudan's National Security Service. Are you aware that he has been arrested and is he going to be released anytime soon?
I am aware of his arrest. Mm-hmm. You know, when you talk peace, because a lot of issues, the president last week had an amnesty issued mm-hmm. for the rebels, those who were fighting. And when you talk of peace process and when you talk of reconciliations, most of the issues, depending on each case, because there are issues to do with if they're a pure criminal case, mm-hmm. they will be handled differently. Mm-hmm. But, you know, anything to do with political activity or somebody who is arrested because of his political activities definitely will be taken care of.
So is there hope that he's going to be released?
I have no reason to doubt if his case was a straightforward case, mm-hmm. a political issue related to peace process or mm-hmm. related to governance. But if it is a criminal issue, mm-hmm. which I'm not aware of, mm-hmm. It will be something different.
One final question. I'm sure you've been in touch with the people of South Sudan, the people on the ground. Mm-hmm. We in Kenya also had our own handshake between the two main, you know, protagonists here, but the people are saying that the handshake is not in touch with the common people on the ground. What are South Sudanese saying with your own handshake between Salva Kiir and Riek Machar?
I just told you earlier, because the peace process, what we are now going through, there is a feeling that, in the general feeling in the South Sudan, that, you know, there is a need for peace. Mm-hmm. So the populations across the board is interested to see that peace is realized. Mm-hmm. So the leaders, yes, have handshake, mm-hmm. but of course with the support of the people on the ground, mm-hmm. the handshake would hold.
Yes.
Because it is the people now supporting leaders. Mm-hmm. If they say no to any leader, mm-hmm. then things will be better.
I understand that the elephant in the room is the two military centers, one by the rebels and the other one by Salva Kiir. Mm-hmm. What guarantee are you going to give the people of South Sudan and perhaps the whole continent that these two factions are going to work together moving forward?
I think the president said it very clearly. You might have listened to what he said earlier. Mm-hmm. When he came back from Khartoum, he made so many meetings. Mm-hmm. The first place he went to was to the army. He went mm-hmm. to the military headquarters mm-hmm. and actually instructed them, first of all, to make sure that at least the ceasefire is holding, mm-hmm. it is respected, and then they have to be prepared to welcome their brothers. That's the term he used. Mm-hmm. You welcome our brothers. All these are South Sudanese. Mm-hmm. There was, of course, differences politically, but when they come back, everybody should feel comfortable, because after all, they are one people. Mm-hmm. It's just difference of views on politics. Mm-hmm. So the guarantee is, again, the people of South Sudan. Mm-hmm.
And have they touched anything to do with resource distribution? Perhaps understand that one of the problems had to do with the revenues that are being accrued from oil. Understand South Sudan has a lot of oil as well.
I've never heard about anybody talking about the resources as an issue. Mm-hmm. I think the issue was about governance in the South, the power struggle. Mm-hmm. There was nothing about resources, because oil is a national wealth. Mm-hmm. Regardless of wherever it would be. I mean, mm-hmm. when it is there, it should be exploited for across the South Sudan. And mm-hmm. I think the same thing applies everywhere. Mm-hmm. So I've never heard of anybody complaining in particular about
resources. It's all about governance.
Governance.
Many thanks, Ambassador Chola Jongo, for your input.
Thank you very much.
On Bottom Line Africa, of course, it's...